that he said, I'll be glad to answer further questions there, but in the interest of time, let me just touch briefly on the third area that Cal asked me to cover, and that would be my time as speaker. It's in this handout that you have, beginning on page 72, if you want to refer to it as I briefly refer to it as well. I do want to touch on one issue that occurred when I was majority floor leader and Senator Opson was appropriate chair, and that's House Bill 1017.
Next slide, Senator, page 33, please. Now, there you go.
Okay. That's
more detail about 1017 than they've had before, so thank you. That's perfect timing.
It was a landmark piece of legislation. The House provided, frankly, the major leadership on it. I think that'd be fair to say. We passed the bill in December in special session. The Senate did not enact it until the following April. It was a major reform and revenue measure for K-12 system. It provided for smaller class sizes. It provided for more emphasis on the basics and the core curriculum in the classroom. You can read all of the initiatives that it covers. But this was a major battle taking us from 1989 through the end of the 1990 legislative session. Steve Lewis, the speaker, it certainly was his signature. Carolyn Thompson Taylor, who many of you know, was heavily involved in it, as was Senator Opson. And in my role as majority leader, I helped get the votes to pass it in the House. I'll just mention a couple of other things, particularly here being at OU during my time as speaker. I was very honored in 92 to serve as the House author of the higher education bond issue, a $350 million bond issue that provided for major improvements on this campus and our campuses around the state. We submitted it to a vote of the people, and they passed overwhelmingly in the 1992 legislative session. I also served and worked with Representative Don McCorkle on the Quality Jobs Bill in the 93 session, which Senator Ted Fisher from Sebulba was also a major player in that space. It provided incentives for companies to locate in Oklahoma or expand. The data some years later indicated it provided for over 100,000 jobs in the state and a payroll in excess of $1.8 million. I want to mention one other thing in terms of my time as speaker. And this really started when Speaker Lewis was speaker. But we made some, I think, concerted efforts to address the image situation of the House of Representatives. We, during that time, through the House rule, eliminated all-night sessions. We basically took the position, nothing after midnight that happens is usually very good. And we were right. And so we eliminated all-night sessions. We provided for proportionate representation between parties on the major committees. We certainly provided some equity and fairness there. We had a provision that required a 24-hour layover on bills from the time they were placed on the House floor before they could be placed on the agenda for a vote, to give members some time at least to review the legislation. We also provided that on retirement legislation, an actuarial report showing the fiscal impact of the retirement bill would need to be on the members' desks at least 3 days in advance before a vote on the bill. A couple of other things we did during that time was actually begin the process that's being done through today of developing an agenda for the House. The Senate does it now, and basically it was a strategy. If you don't have your own agenda, you are reacting to the agenda that's being submitted by the governor. So we felt representing the 101 members of the House, it was important to have our own agenda, which oftentimes coincided with the governor. Sometimes it didn't in every way, shape, or form, and that's what the process is all about. But I think historically, you can look back on that now as a change in the evolution of the professionalism in the House. If you think about it, and I don't know if Cal's covered this or not, but we became a state in 1907. Until 1961, if you can imagine this, the governor picked the Speaker of the House and the President of the Senate. And in 1961, J.D. McCarty said, we're not going to do that anymore. We're a separate, equal branch of government. We need to pick our own leaders. But the process of picking the Speaker of the Pro Tem has only been a phenomenon that we have followed since 1961. So here in the early 90s, developing our own agenda and bringing that forward before the session was another element in the evolution of the professionalism of the House of Representatives. So with that, I could go on. Let me stop and devote the rest of time to questions.
That is perfect. Thank you, Mr. Speaker and Chancellor. Let's go to class members first. And Sarah, would you please put up slide 41. Questions for, yes, Dr. Waller. Thank you. John Waller.
My experience with declining revenue is that you can trim and trim and trim. The time comes when you have to walk. Are we close? And I hear various numbers that the state provides something like 13% of the budget for this university. It seems, if that were me, I would really do some looking at taking the university private, or taking at least one of the 25, 20-something colleges private as a test. Is there any?
Let me respond to your first question after you cut successively, then you get to the point where you're taking major hunks out of the core, and that I think we're at that point. Over 8 years, $240 million. OU shares about 25% of that. This last year, $37 million. Your numbers are right on track. I think you may be right. It may be down to 30% now. The last figure, in fact, is that what it shows, that OU has 13%? If it does, I will contest that. I know the Health Sciences Center, Dr. Alstatt's right at 8% of state funding. So, I mean, as to your issue, why don't they just go private? I would not speak for the Regents here or the present board, but you from a practice standpoint, you have to look at where that 13% is going to come from.
Any organization I know that they can make up 13%.
Well, okay. I mean, so it's arguable. I guess what I would say is that really is a major departure from what all of this started to be going back to Abraham Lincoln in 1862, when the feeling was that to that point the opportunity for higher education was essentially elitist and private, and that there needed to be a strong public university system in this country to provide those opportunities for the middle class. Now, granted, as you look at these numbers, as you cite the numbers that you provide, we are moving years and years away from that. Again, I think we've got to look at, I don't think we want to be in a position where, as I see every year, I was president of a university in Durant, Southeastern Oklahoma State University, where nearly 60 to 70% of those students were first generation college students, the first of their family.
That's what a state university is for. That's what it's for.
Exactly.
That's its purpose.
Yeah, well, I would submit we have students like that here too.
I mean, you got to have the money.
You got to have the money.
And
again, I think what it should mean is we need to redouble the efforts. Quite candidly, I mean, I'm just going to share this. I don't know if you look at what punches the buttons there at the Capitol. Higher education can't get 30,000 teachers there at the Capitol for a rally. We don't have those numbers. And to some degree, I think that type of approach has been effective, which means we need to look at other options other than that.
Hold on just a second. Ken was first, then I'll come over here. But before those questions, let me just point out something. This chart is a modification of a chart we received from David Black's organization up in Tulsa. We, Sarah added this blue box, Mr. Speaker. This might be of interest to you. If you go back to fiscal year, that's when I was pro tem. It's no particular coincidence, but it's totally a coincidence. Higher education, our education, receives about 60% of this pie, okay? 60%. Right now, the education pie, and I'm talking about higher ed, common, and career tech, wherever that little sliver is, right there. They are struggling to get to 49% total. You can make the argument what the hell difference is 11%. Well, it's huge. It's huge. That that is the world that they're living in. Mr. Speaker, we're going to go to you.
So the only comment I'd make on that is, so where did the, if education goes down from 60 to 49, where'd the money go? Because it is a zero-sum game. It went to transportation. It went to health care, primarily through Medicaid. Went to Department of Human Services, and it went to corrections. So those areas have seen increases during that same time period.
And also tax cuts.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can you answer? Would you give us your general opinion at this point of the new House Speaker McCall and his approach to this legislative session and hearing and having the hearings and so on and so forth?
Really good question. I got acquainted with Speaker McCall when I was at President Southeastern Durant. He is his family owns the bank in Atoka, and that's one of our major feeder schools, high schools, if you will. His father's was on our alumni board. I like him. I think he's, in fact, if you look at this history that we talked about, at the time I ran for Speaker, I'd been in office 8 years. By the time you were pro tem, you'd been in office probably, 20?
22.
Okay. Here he is elected Speaker after 4 years. So you're looking at a much different, and I'm not saying that as a negative at all. I think he's ready for the job. He's very measured. He's very steady. He doesn't jump out, and he's not looking for a headline every day. But in this legislature, I think he's a steady hand. I would. You just look at some of the things he's done the first month or two that have been a little thorny. He seems to have been attempting to wade through the thicket in a good way. As to his request to have the hearings, the appropriation hearings before the full House, initially I was not too excited about it because I was concerned we'd get in there and just get all kinds of questions that were really not related to the budget. But after going through the 4.5 hour, nearly 5 hour process, I came away feeling pretty good about it. The reason I did, it gave every member a chance to ask questions. And quite frankly, it gave me and us a chance to respond. You know, we had questions. One of the first questions, well, I don't know if you all had a chance to watch the hearing. It was, they live streamed it. And one of the questions was, well, you know, these faculty don't teach. And it gave me the opportunity to point out at the 2-year and regional level that they teach either five to six sections at our two research institutions. They are function for research. So obviously every single member of our faculty doesn't teach full time every day because they have different functions that involve research and other components involved in higher education, clinical work, physician's practice, things of that nature. And frankly, at the end of the discussion, I had members who told me, they said, you know, I never really looked at it that way. I never really had the opportunity. There were questions about our tuition being the highest in the region and gave me a chance with data to show that that's absolutely wrong and that we are, based on what I said earlier, either fourth or fifth most affordable in the entire country. And the 16-member Southern Regional Education Board states, which is basically southeastern states in the United States, bordered by Maryland and Delaware in the north, Florida, Texas, and Oklahoma, we're ranked 16th out of 16 in tuition fees. So it was a good opportunity, and I shared with the speaker that if he wants to do that again next year, I'd be supportive, because I do think the more we can do, particularly if you can imagine this, you may have counted them up. Of the 149 members of the House, 50 are new members. So a third of the legislature is walking in the door last Monday for the first time. And again, with all due respect, it's on us to provide them the information they need to make those decisions. So I come out of it feeling that the hearing before the full House, although it took a long time, I think was probably a good plan, at least in the House of Representatives.
Councilor Ryan.
I'm kind of the opinion that the penny sales tax would have had a significantly better chance of passing if it had not, if it had been limited to common education. And I'm also, when I ask around, I get the feeling that we have the higher education system that the majority of Oklahomans want. In fact, maybe a majority of us think we have too much. How can we change that perception? You're talking about doing it at the representative level, but we need to change, we need to educate and change that at the voter level. How do we do that?
Well, okay, I'll take the first part of the question first. I think there was polling data that confirmed what your assertion was, that if the state question had been only dealing with Common Ed, it might have had a better chance of passage. There was some polling data that showed that. Then you look at it from a broader perspective, the number of those that opposed it, some of the exit polling showed they were going to be against any tax. So, but I think it's a fair point to say that, which means that as far as the general population, they may not see some of this data that we talk about in terms of lifetime earnings being so much more, producing college graduates to fill these job needs that are out there. They may not feel that that is as compelling as I think that we know that it is, and therefore, you know, again, we've got to do more to make that case. When students aren't able to take the courses they need to graduate on time, we hear about it. But I don't know that that's reached the critical mass to this point that it's going to need to in order to get the movement that we need. You raise the issue of too many institutions and that possibly being part of the equation, that there may be too many, or that at least there's discussion that there may be too many. Where the national average shows that 30% of adults 25 and older have college degrees in Oklahoma, that percentage is 24%. So access to college is important. With all these avenues we have today, with online education and others, there's other ways to do that. But I would share something that's sort of interesting, because we get this question in the legislature, and that is, well, we just have way too many colleges. So we go back, and Senator Hobson remembers this, we look going back to 1989, and there have been, by legislative authorization, 17 additional campuses authorized through the legislature. There haven't been any closed. So, you know, whatever, some might say that's anecdotal, but going back to all the way from the campus in Salisoff or Carl Albert to all of those that were added in Tulsa to branch campuses in areas like Duncan and Woodward and Idabel, time and time again, the legislature has authorized additional campuses. And the only conclusion I think you can draw is, well, why would that be important? Because those areas believe that bringing higher education to those regions of the state is important. And so even though there's discussion that we may have too many, in terms of what's actually happened legislatively has been just the opposite.
On that point, and there was a question over here, and Lady had somebody. So beside that point, the theory goes in legislation, by God, if my neighbor can have a damn old prison, I think I'll get me a junior college. So I understand that argument, but the closest we ever came to closing a college was for all the wrong reason. It is a great liberal college. I'm talking about USAO over in Chickasha. You could guess forever as to why we almost closed that. Speaker will remember.
I think maybe I didn't phrase my question. How do those of us that believe in higher education convince Joe Blow and actually the voter, not his representative, the voters in Oklahoma, that this is a good thing?
You better start with the representatives before you go to Joe Blow, the voter, because
you think the representative, if you convince the representative will convince the voter.
I do, and actually, the other thing is, it's sort of interesting. The polling data shows that there's more support for higher education statewide than might have been reflected with the cut that occurred last year. But I agree with Cal. I think you've got to start with the person that's up there at the Capitol making a decision for their district.
Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned that money that could have gone to education instead went to health care. was that impacted by our state's refusal to accept federal dollars?
Oh, it might have been, but my bigger issue is, since the time period that Senator Hobson referenced, 2004, you've seen several things happen. When higher ed, or not higher ed, all of education is getting 60%. Department of Transportation, and let me say this at the outset, I'm not against any of these areas, but Department of Transportation submitted the 8-year plan, and that's resulted in ongoing funding for them that's increased over time. Department of Human Services, because of some federal interventions, have embraced the Pinnacle Plan, which has provided for an increase in their budget. I think we all know what's going on in corrections. Senator Hobson carried that water for many, many years there. And with the overcrowding issue, increases there. So again, I mean, it is a zero-sum game. Healthcare, just because, I mean, on top of everything else, it's just healthcare costs have increased. And as all of those things have come on, when I said it's a zero-sum game, as those areas of the budget increase, there are going to be other areas that correspondingly decrease, and the biggest category that decreased was education.
Now, on that very good point, in a as a percent, this monster right here, Medicaid, not to be confused with Medicare, that has exploded in all states. That is where we do indeed get federal money based on per capita income in your state. So the poorer your state is, the higher percent of the federal money to match the state dollars. But there's big time state dollars. But you've heard me talk about the fact that we've been our own worst enemy by not accepting Obamacare, ACA, whatever you want to call it. And a poll came out this weekend that's very interesting that indicated that the confusion still between Obamacare and ACA, over 40% of the folks said they are two different things.
That's right.
Obamacare, you all heard the same before. Mm-hmm. And ACA, Affordable Care Act, two different things. The numbers get even crazier. We're about 3 minutes after five, but we're going to continue on. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Just let me comment. I think it is absolutely pathetic that you must spend your time and resources arguing against guns on campus. Yeah. That is just, I'm so sorry.
Well, thank you for saying that. But I feel very strongly that if we don't push that all the way to the end and put our shoulder to the wheel, it'll happen. I mean, it's happened in Texas 2 years ago. So we are really, in many ways, kind of that last stopgap, if you will. I appreciate you saying it, but we don't have any choice.
Yeah.
Well, and on that very good point, Mr. Speaker, I want you to come with me to Henrietta on the 26th. We will very quickly change the topic from dancing to why the hell they don't have guns to protect themselves at the Botoa Junior College. Yes, ma'am.
One question. Do you have to be registered to vote in Henrietta?
Well, not according to Donald Trump, but according to most people, yes, you have to be registered to vote in this or any other state. Surely we have others who vote. The Chancellor has come a long way. For friendly questions, yes, ma'am?
I don't have a question, but I certainly hope when you were talking to the legislators about the efficacy of higher education and the people who don't teach classes, that researchers bring in billions of dollars to the state of Oklahoma.
Last year's Senator commitment would be, yes, I do lead with that front and center. And they're vital to everything that we do in this state. This article, this op-ed piece that I put in your packet from Congressman Cole and me, goes into that point in some detail.
And to be fair, I'll come over there right away. To be fair, the legislature, even since statehood, you know, we've not all been stellar supporters of higher education, even as big spending Democrats. The proof of that is we've been a grand total of three higher ed bond issues since statehood. A little bitty one up in Alpha when the housing units at Northwestern went busted. That's the only bond issue for our education we've ever defaulted on. The state had to step in on that. The other two, Mr. Speaker offered the one in 1992 of $350 million with a lot of help from Regents and others. David Walters was the governor at the time, and I was the author of the third one in 2005, the $500 million bond issue. As I told you before, our boys and girls up there, suddenly I've learned, are not these bond issues, as long as they get to spend a $500 million on the capital where they live. I'm for the capital. But when they ignore, for example, your own health lab, where you go to get your shots or anything else, until it's a crisis, I think that's foolish. We have more questions. You have a couple more minutes. I know you have. Okay, somebody over here. No, over here, sir.
Do you think when you argue no tuition and affordability of Oklahoma colleges, you feed the argument that they just need to raise tuition to make things work out?
Well, I think this.
Would you repeat that for everybody?
If I understood the question, the fact that we've made an effort to keep tuition low, does that feed the argument that
raise tuition and solve the problem?
Yeah, I don't. I think again, the reason our regents have kept tuition the way that they have is based on several factors. One being, in our state, examining all those factors, we've got to be careful that we don't set tuition in a way where it really does take it out of the reach of a good number of our students in the system and their parents who are helping them. You know, that being said, I mean, again, probably no surprise, but even with the moderate increases that we've had, I'm sure you won't be surprised to know that when the regents take that action, there is objection by some in the public policy arena, we've raised it too much.
Yes, sir, Dr. Thompson.
There's one statistic that I think is by far the most important when it comes to Common Ed, but it also applies to healthcare, it applies to juvenile justice, mental health, applies to everything up there. And that is the percentage of young people who've survived multiple traumas. And we're tied with West Virginia for number one in the country. And in 2014, the numbers came out and they were absolutely shocking. Well, we have the preliminary data was released last week, and we're still number one in the country with kids who survived multiple trauma. But the numbers we had understated. The numbers are double what we had thought in 2014 and dwarf any other place in the country. It's 45%. Up from 22% has survived multiple trauma. And that works its way through every part of that pie chart.
Thank you, John. And Mr. Speaker, I know you are always punctual and have to run. We cannot thank you enough for coming today. We appreciate it very much. What we're going to do is take our quick 5 minutes, come back, and do a little history lesson.